Nebraska, America. A special ambulance service is called out on its most extraordinary mission. To get to their patient, they have to knock down one wall of his house. Inside is a man who weighs half a ton.
Even as an obesity surgeon, I had never come across a human being that was still breathing that was anything like his size.
Patrick Deuel weighs as much as 5 baby elephants. The weight bearing down on his vital organs is killing him.
When he rolled to his back, he could not breathe because the weight would prevent his lungs from expanding and contracting.
He was literally being crushed by this huge mound of his weight, and you could not explain that to people, even in words. You really had to see it.
As doctors struggle to save the world's heaviest man, scientists are searching for answers. Why is it that for some people like Patrick Deuel, the desire to eat is greater than the will to live? After 7 years of being trapped at home, Patrick weighed 76 stone, and his body was deteriorating dangerously.
You can't roll me up onto this side at all. Okay.
We noticed that he had a lot of weeping tissue, which means his skin had stretched beyond capacity and that the fluid from his body had basically seeped out and saturated the sheets. He had blood and or fecal matter on his hands, under his fingernails.
For months, Patrick had lain face down, waiting for his life to end.
He had to have the TV on all the time, 24 hours a day. And I always felt that he had that TV on so that even if he was sleeping, that sound was there and he knew he was still alive.
The only hospital that could save Patrick was 6 hours away. The team had a major concern. If he stopped breathing, they wouldn't be able to turn him over to revive him.
That created a very unusual challenge for us, since Patrick couldn't breathe on his back. And with no neck, or no neck to speak of, putting an airway in would be almost impossible.
No mask or anything, but I'm going to turn on some oxygen. And just kind of put that down by your face, okay?
Patrick told me right to my face, he said, Dad, I think I'm gonna die. And I couldn't lie to him. I said, Pat, you might.
Weight had always been a problem for Patrick. At 4 years old, he weighed 6 stone.
He didn't necessarily eat more, he just gained faster. People said, well, it's baby fat, it's healthy, it won't be a problem. They said he'll lose the baby fat as he gets older. Oh, but he really never did.
Betty banned sweets and did her best to make sure the family had a healthy diet. But Patrick always had room for more.
Patrick always said that when he sat down to eat, he could eat a full-sized meal as much as anybody else did, and he was still hungry. He was always hungry.
He never felt full.
Patrick made it to hospital. But by now, he was drowning in his own fluid.
The thing that was actually killing him was he was not able to keep up with the demands of the heart. And he had probably 200 pounds of water within the tissues. So he was going to die of congestive heart failure, literally within weeks to days.
We can turn the whole bed.
Patrick's obesity was way beyond what even experts had seen. 30 stone is considered to be medically life-threatening, and Dr. Harris was stunned to find a patient who weighed more than double that.
At the time I first met him, he was advertised as being in the 800-pound range. It was clear when I took one look in the room that this was something way over that, and that this was something that you don't see but once in a career.
Patrick, is this a good position for you?
Is that?
Is this a good position for you?
14 stone of Patrick's weight was fluid. Dr. Harris knew it would go quickly on a crash diet, but he couldn't starve him. Patrick was suffering from malnutrition.
Lots of people think because you're taking in all these calories that you're going to be well nourished, and the answer is no. He was taking in lots of calories, but he was not taking in high quality calories. Lots of fats and lots of carbohydrates.
Dr. Harris's team of nutritionists devised a special diet. Patrick was to eat a tenth of what he normally ate. The results were miraculous.
It was either buckle down and do it or skip it. Go home, die. And Dr. Harris had told me, he said, while you're in the hospital, you're going to do what I tell you.
Organization plan. And Burger King hopes to cash in on the non-dieters. The fast food giant launched its new enormous omelet today. Two eggs, two slices of cheese, a sausage patty, three strips of bacon, and a bun. For nutritional experts are appalled. Burger King says it's just offering choice.
Local reporter Jane Andrews made the half-ton man's fight for life into worldwide news.
Patrick Deuel came into this world weighing a very average 7 pounds, 12 ounces. And almost from that very moment, he has been fighting the needle on the scale. But as you are about to see,
when we first met him, he would have trouble breathing, even to complete an entire sentence. By the time we saw him in October, he had lost so much weight that conversation was quite easy for him. He laughed more.
All of a sudden, I could roll over by myself. Then they had the machine help me sit up. And I could sit up by myself. That was great.
But just 8 weeks into his fight of a lifetime, Patrick is already moving ahead of schedule.
I love my sweetie is eating. I'll love her for life because she is my new wife.
All those steps were amazing, going from not being able to do anything to being able to walk around and do things. I was keeping track of pounds lost rather than how much does he weigh, because to me that the pounds lost was the encouragement, you know.
There, I got rid of it.
And so the 1 week that he didn't lose very much, but I said to him, but you've already lost this much, you know, don't get discouraged, you can keep on doing it.
Before Patrick met Edie, his only date had been at a school prom when someone lost a bet. After years of being on his own, he put an ad in the Lonely Hearts column.
I knew that I was going to marry her the minute she walked in the door. She was gorgeous.
Fat, 40, and short, but he thought I was
just
gorgeous.
Just the way I like him.
So you weren't put off by his size?
No, because I looked at this much of him, and I saw the talk to him, and I saw the personality, and I saw the fun-loving person, and I saw the intelligent person, and I think we even talked about music, didn't we?
Mm-hmm. Edie was Patrick's first and only girlfriend, but their marriage has never been consummated.
We don't have a sexual relationship. We're looking forward to one when he gets his weight down, but there has not been one. It's not possible.
After 4 months of being on a crash diet, Patrick was nearly half his original weight. But Dr. Harris knew from experience that compulsive eaters like Patrick leave hospital and can put all the weight back on.
Had he, as he could have done, left the hospital at 600 pounds and gone home to try to do that on his own, it's my suspicion it took us 4 to 5 months to get it off. I think he'd had it back on and been dead in 3 months.
When Patrick Deuel was rushed to hospital, he weighed 76 stone. His only chance of survival was a strictly controlled diet, but he still tried to break the rules.
When family and friends would come, they had to kind of be frisked by the nursing staff to make sure that there was no contraband. And he would negotiate. If he could con some student nurse into bringing him a real Coke, away we'd go.
Dr. Harris decided there was only one way to stop Patrick overeating, an operation to reduce the size of his stomach.
In gastric bypass surgery, the surgeon uses a row of staples to seal off most of the stomach, leaving a small pouch on top. This restricts food intake. The small intestine is then attached to the pouch, which reduces the absorption of calories and nutrients.
He'll have an incision that goes from his breastbone down to his belly button, and maybe below that, if necessary, to get adequate exposure.
Patrick's stomach would be reduced to the size of a thumb. It simply wouldn't be able to take in large amounts of food anymore.
The stomach on the morbid obese typically is much bigger than the stomach on the normal. Why? Because you eat enough food that you stretch it all the time. And in Patrick's case, it was huge. I could have probably got 3 quarts, 3 liters into Patrick's. So he had this huge storage capacity where when he came across pizza, he couldn't just eat X number of slices, he could eat 3 times X number of slices as you might be able to eat.
You get it.
Thank you.
Well, Patrick, how do you make it out in there?
Like a side of Nebraska beef going to market, but I'm doing okay.
Today, after 6 months in hospital, Patrick is going home. At 44 stone, he's nearly half his previous weight. Now it will be up to him and his wife, Edie, to fight his urge to overeat.
Sir.
With us buying what he says he wants for meals and only having that in the house, no chips, no, you know, the extra things, which I don't eat anyway, I think we can do it.
But Patrick is still at risk. Although his stomach is tiny, if he eats continuously, he'll put the weight back on.
It's not a risk, it will be a fact. If Patrick goes back and grazes, the unfortunate reality is he'll not only regain the weight, but he'll probably regain it faster than it was taken off in the hospital environment. So if that happens, he'll go back into congestive failure, he'll drown in his own secretions, and he'll do it reasonably promptly if he has uncontrolled intake of calories.
Patrick has been given strict instructions on what he can eat. The new regime will be a challenge for Edie, too. Their neighbors remember how she used to feed Patrick his favorite foods in bed.
Restore unto me.
There was times when he had snacks laying on the headboard of his bed and stuff that probably a man in that condition probably shouldn't have had. Cinnamon pinwheel things or pecan twirls or whatever they call them sitting up there.
When he said, I want this, if it was in my power and in the grocery budget, I got it for him. Partially because he couldn't get out and go do things himself. You need to be there and support and love and concern and show, you know, show in the way that he understands that you care.
I think we got three there. Oh, yeah, okay.
When Patrick married Edie, he already weighed 50 stone. After 10 years together, his waist had expanded to 7.5 feet.
I hadn't realized how bad he was. I knew he was this big, but I hadn't realized how bad it looked until I saw these pictures.
I think Edie actually has a really, really deep love for him, but I think sometimes love can be blinding. In that situation, it needed somebody that was strong enough to say no more. You know, I even caught myself thinking one day, well, how's that any different than assisted suicide?
When you got married to him, why didn't you just take him in hand? Why didn't you say, I'm gonna put you on a diet, I'm gonna get you healthier?
He would have still said, well, honey, I need chips.
Easiest way in the world to alienate me is to tell me not to do something or tell me I can't do something.
His
I'll rip you to shreds.
Mm-hmm. Now Patrick's food choices are limited. 3 months after leaving hospital, he's feeling the effects of having his stomach reduced.
Everything makes you sick. You can only eat 1 ounce of something every 20 minutes. And depending on what they give you, if your stomach decides you can or can't or will or won't take it, you could put something down there and throw it right back up.
Patrick has lost weight by eating less, but he insists that even when he was supersize, he never ate more than anyone else.
When Patrick was really big, when he was, you know, over 1,000 pounds, how much was he eating then?
I keep thinking from the way you're asking the questions that you keep expecting her to say, oh my God, he was eating half the refrigerator a day, we had $1,200 a month grocery bills, stuff like that. That wasn't the deal. We're talking genetics here. We're not talking volume.
And really,
genetics means that when you have weight to lose, it doesn't want to come off regardless of what you eat.
Dr. Harris thinks Patrick's metabolism is the same as anyone else's, but he believes Patrick was driven to eat huge amounts. Just to maintain his weight of 76 stone, he must have eaten 15,000 calories per day. That's 15 large pizzas.
Even as a young man, if you had followed him around for a day with a video camera, he and his parents both would have been at odds to how many times he really went to the refrigerator.
It might not be greed that is driving Patrick's huge appetite. For years, scientists have been searching for reasons why people overeat. 10 years ago, they identified a gene that could be responsible. The difference between these mice was a gene that produced a single protein hormone in the brain called leptin. The mice without it were always hungry, overate, and became obese.
Same environment, same capacity for exercise, same access at water and food, and yet you've got this one mouse, same as his cousin, except for one little genetic focus, who's now morbidly obese, and his genetic cousin is a normal mouse.
Since then, scientists have gone on to discover many other genes that seem to determine our desire to overeat.
You see that between people who are of the same family, brothers and sisters, some of which would be skinny and some of which would be morbidly obese.
Dr. Harris's belief in the fat gene theory comes from personal experience. He was once so overweight, he couldn't work.
Couldn't get in the boat, couldn't get out of the boat, couldn't hunt pheasant, couldn't stand and do an entire day's worth of operating without feeling wretched about it.
He maintains it wasn't greed, but his genetic makeup that made him overeat.
Where you'll eat the meal and be perfectly content, not eat again for 6 to 8 hours, I'm going to eat the meal and at 2 hours I'm going to be looking for another meal.
Dr. Harris was so desperate to stop overeating, he decided to have his stomach reduced. He's convinced that it takes more than willpower to eat less if you have the fat gene.
And you can either accept that that's genetic, or you can decide that those people who are morbidly obese are weak-willed, fat, lazy, and disgusting people who are not as good as I am because I'm skinny.
Scientists think that years ago, some people developed this fat gene to help them survive famine. But with today's high-fat diet and couch potato lifestyle, that helpful gene has become something that can kill us.
I'm sure he knew what he was doing to himself. It was obvious. I was aware that I was doing when I was gaining weight. But the drive is just so strong that even you know that, man, I'm going to feel wretched if I do this, they do it anyway.
So he'd rather die than stop eating?
Came close.
Sweetie? Diet Wild Cherry Pepsi, please.
All right. It's been 3 months since Patrick left hospital. He's trying to stick to his new regime.
So is Patrick on a special diet?
As far as a special diet is concerned, no, there really isn't one. Just the amount of calories intake is mainly what we're watching.
So how many would be in that breakfast, do you think?
Have no idea.
There are only a handful of people in the world like Patrick who weigh over 60 stone, but the numbers are getting higher. More people than ever are eating themselves to death.
Why? Because we're compulsive overeaters. We have not learned to establish our priorities when it comes to food.
Rosalie Bradford ate her way into the record books. At 85 stone, she was 10 stone heavier than Patrick at his biggest. Even those close to her didn't know how much she was eating.
I have so many tricks that it would just make you laugh. I had this one big furry, fluffy dog, and Bob would be cooking dinner, he'd bring me my food, and I'd wait a little bit and I'd yell, "Darn you, dog, what'd you do that for?" So I would pretend the dog took my pork chop or my chicken leg or something, and I had it anyway. So Bob would bring me extra and I'd keep that for a little bit later. But you know, addicts, alcoholics, we're all liars.
Rosalie weighed 25 stone when she married. After her son was born, her weight went up. It finally hit 85 stone when she was confined to her bed because of an illness.
I ate nonstop, and then you know, just being so incredibly inactive.
Did you realize that you were getting so much bigger?
Yes, I knew I was getting a lot bigger because the spot where Bob had to sleep was getting a lot smaller. Yeah.
Did you look in the mirror at all?
I didn't get out of bed for almost 10 years.
Rosalie's compulsion damaged the lives of everyone around her. Little Rob was too embarrassed to explain why his mum never left the house.
He told some of his friends, he told them that his mom was dead because he didn't know how to explain. Yeah.
Rosalie was 8 feet wide when she was taken by the fire service to hospital. Her life was in danger until America's number one weight loss guru phoned her out of the blue.
And he said it was Richard Simmons. And I said, "Who?" And he said, "Richard Simmons." And I said, "Yeah, right, I'm Mother Teresa. Now, who is this?" You know.
Richard Simmons is America's king of Keep Fit. His Farewell to Fat program may have made him a multimillionaire, but helping America's obese is a genuine personal crusade.
Am I going to make you slim and beautiful? No, you are going to make you slim and beautiful.
Over the years, he's picked up the phone and become a lifeline to hundreds of people like Rosalie.
You can learn how to finally say farewell to fat for yourself. Welcome.
I'm the one that picks them up. I'm the one that dusts them off, and then I'm the one that gives them the hope.
Richard called me every single day. You know, why are you eating? And I really started to focus, am I really hungry? Or do I just want to eat to satisfy, you know, whatever?
Rosalie doesn't look to her genes to explain her weight. She thinks her problem started when she was young. Her mum abandoned her as a baby, and she believes food became her only comfort.
Most children, when you say, "Well, what did you do at somebody's house?" "Well, we played a game, or we did this or that." And I can remember not that much of what we did, but I can remember focusing on the snacks that we would get.
Everyone is emotional, but some of us are acutely emotional, and our emotions flare up and we don't want to face them, so we want to pull the covers over, and you do that with spaghetti and meatballs and prime rib and apple pie with ice cream, and you think at the time it's going to make things better.
I like to feel the food in here. I like to feel it go down here. I like the feel emotionally. It solves. It solves problems.
I always tell people, food never solves any of your problems, past, present, or future.
Richard's philosophy comes from personal experience. He spent a lifetime battling with his weight and binge eating. And
go. I am a compulsive eater. Food at an early age meant more to me than just about anything. And while I was eating the first piece of chicken, I was eyeing to see what other piece of chicken I wanted.
What is it? Let me hear it. Sweating plus toning equals health. Am I right about this formula?
Richard's solution was common sense. It worked for him, and he spread the word to America's obese. He told them to drop the fad diets, eat sensibly, and exercise.
When they come up with hereditary genes, and it's genes, it's genetic, I think maybe teeny, 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 teeny percentage. The rest, there isn't a person I haven't met who can't lower their calories, lower their fat grams, sweat a little bit more, and step on the scale and go, I'm down 4 pounds. That worked. Let's see, if I do that for 10 weeks in a row, I go, wait, it's not for 10 weeks in a row, it's forever.
Couch plus donuts equals fat. Am I right?
When Rosalie followed Richard's food plan, she experienced a feeling in her stomach she had never had before.
He says, you're feeling hunger. Yeah, but I never felt hunger because there was constantly food all the time. I mean, can you imagine these folks in other countries, they don't know what it's like to be full. And here I live here in America, thank God for America, but I never felt hunger.
With Richard's help, Rosalie lost 65 stone in 10 years.
Can you imagine just going into a bathroom and doing your hair? And going in using the loo, you know? I mean, remarkable. I didn't have those experiences for years.
Hey, Bob, you hungry?
Supporters of the fat gene theory are convinced that people like Rosalie are trapped in a cycle. If they lose weight, they'll always put it back on.
If you come back in 5 years and she's still off, then I challenge you to come back at 10 years, and then I challenge you to come back at 15 years. And I guarantee before she dies, she'll fall off the wagon.
It would kill me. I'm just sure it would. You know, God cut me a break. I don't want to be a fool and screw it up.
I see somebody, they lose 50 pounds, and then I see them 6 months later, and they gain back 50 plus, plus 60.
Fat gene or not, Richard Simmons believes there's only one way to fight obesity.
We're going to go over some of these formulas right now, and I want to see if you can relate to any of these formulas, okay? Just let me know.
But it can be tough.
C plus D.
This is a death sentence. This is hell. When I die, I know I'm going to heaven because this, I've done my hell time.
Just a year ago, Patrick Deuel was the world's heaviest man. His doctors were worried that once he left hospital, he'd put all the weight he'd lost back on. But he's lost even more.
I'm starting to sag and bag in a lot of places, but I'm getting thinner.
We can see his bones. His hands aren't as big as they were. I mean, they're still large hands, but they aren't as big as they were. And his face, you can see his face has lost weight, and his shoulders.
Patrick was trapped in his house for 7 years. Now Edie can show him the town he lives in, but had never seen.
We went past the church that I go to, and we went past the pharmacy, and we went past the place that I worked during the summer last summer, and the places that I go to all the time and he knows about, but he'd never seen before.
Patrick seems to be winning his battle. But long-term success stories are rare in the world of the super obese.
Well, chubbies, be of good cheer. We're going to meet a 37-year-old New Yorker who a couple of years ago was given only a week to live. He weighed 64 and a half stones.
Michael Habranko is famous for one thing. He's lost more weight than any other man. In 19 months, he lost 50 stone and became a worldwide celebrity.
So let's meet the remarkable Michael Habranko. What was the factor that made you want to lose weight then?
I was at a point in my life, I had a 10-year-old son that was already almost 160 pounds. Daddy took extra spaghetti, my son Mikey took extra macaroni. And I tried to commit suicide. I didn't have the nerve to pull the trigger. I didn't want to live, but I couldn't go on. I didn't have the nerve to kill myself.
There was one man Michael thought could help him. He'd never met Richard Simmons, but he wrote him a letter. A lifetime friendship began, and Michael was able to lose weight for the first time in his life. He got down to 14 stone.
I watch what I eat, I follow my program, and I do a lot of physical. I just keep very active.
But don't you miss the food?
Oh, all the time. All the time. I am still addicted to food, but I like myself more now. I like the freedom. I like the ability to be my own person. Never again. Life is too worth it. I love living.
It wasn't just Michael's body that changed. He started to behave differently, too.
If I tell you that I actually didn't like his personality as a thin man, you might think I'm crazy, but I felt that he became very self-centered and things like that. It wasn't the best time in our lives.
Michael even won himself a role in one of Richard Simmons' fitness videos. It seemed to the world he'd kicked his habit, but those close to him suspected otherwise.
Michael did not recognize the new Michael. You go from a man who's housebound to a man dancing and starring in a video and having his own motivation classes, but along the way he drifted.
All of a sudden I had women that didn't care that I was wearing a wedding band. And my poor wife was going through hell.
Aww.
But Madeline needn't have worried.
Oh, yeah.
The temptation of food proved far greater for Michael than any temptation of the flesh.
A half hour after I hit 198 pounds, I went out and celebrated and had four Frankfurters. I hadn't had a Nathan's hot dog in 19 months. And loving the hot dogs, I went and had one, thinking I could eat one. One turned into two, two turned into three, three turned into four. And you can't have a hot dog without French fries. And you can't have French fries without the melted cheese on it. So that's where it started.
And this is where it ended. 7 years after his Wogan appearance, Michael was forklifted onto a stretcher for transporting killer whales.
Every time I slipped, where normal people would gain 5 pounds, my binges would be 20 pounds. I mean, if I sat down and ate pork chops, I would sit down and eat 24 pork chops. Hot dogs would be 20 to 22 hot dogs for dinner. If I had breakfast, it would be a dozen scrambled eggs.
When Michael was taken to hospital, he weighed 5 stone more than he'd ever been before. Now, he was over 70 stone.
Let's go. Don't make it like a spectacle. No. Let people understand that this is a disease and that people are dying from it. It's the number one secondary cause of death in this country. Please, it's not a circus act.
Good luck to you.
Back it up, please.
I eat out of boredom. I eat whenever food is around. I think of food when there's no food around. I think of food constantly, 24 hours a day. I have gone through all kinds of psychoanalysis. If I could find out the answer, I have been searching and searching, And I will continue searching until, if this disease gets the best of me and takes me to my grave.
Portion it out.
Before you sit down.
Before you sit down. If you open this bag and start eating from it, you will finish the whole bag before you know.
Right.
You don't want to belong to the Finish Your Plate Club.
Once again, Michael was desperate to find help. His search led him to a unique rehabilitation center in New York. Brookhaven specializes in treating morbidly obese people.
If there is a fat gene that exists in my patients, it's not reversible today. There is no cure for it, but it is treatable.
Okay, ready to stand? One, two, move forward. Come on. Grab the walker. Come on.
Many of the patients at Brookhaven have been trapped in their homes and haven't walked for years.
You gotta work through the pain. Sometimes you gotta do that.
Rob Coleman founded Brookhaven when a friend of his died of morbid obesity. He believes that his patients have one thing in common.
Every one of them, 100%, they're food addicts. They are addicted to food. It's no different than drugs. It's no different than alcohol.
Good job.
Sometimes it's hard to get the patients to understand that they're addicted to food.
Take a deep breath.
Most of the patients who come in here are in denial and don't understand why this has happened to them. What's wrong with me? How did I blow up like this? The answer is that you've been consuming too many calories over a long period of time and you don't exercise.
Per serving, 100 calories.
The patients are taught the simple mathematics of getting thinner. They just need to burn more calories than they consume.
And how many calories is the whole liter then? Wow. 800 calories in that bar. It's extremely important to learn how to read labels. You could drink four or five of those.
No problem. Throughout the day, without a doubt, with some ice. Sure.
And what do you do now?
Now I do not. I stay away from that. I try to drink more diet soda. Yeah. I try to drink more. Water, coffee, tea, things like that. Right.
So if I ate about 50,
I have
20,
one resident who likes oranges. He can eat a tremendous quantity of oranges. Oranges are healthy for you. He doesn't understand. I eat oranges all day, every day. Why am I gaining weight? You eat 45 of anything and you're going to gain weight.
After losing 21 stone at Brookhaven, Michael Habranko thought it was safe to go home. But it was too big a step. Once again, he was unable to stop eating.
I had to be on my own, and I had to eat. And I did all right the first day and the second day. But then there was the holidays, and there was this, and there was a little slip here and a slip there. How successful would our alcoholics be if they had to have a drink every day? Just one. How successful would a heroin addict be if he had to take a little heroin every day?
Ooh, how about pineapple upside down cake?
Yes, pineapple upside down cake.
Oh, I love that. Oh. Especially take that fresh pineapple.
With obesity as one of America's biggest health issues, government scientists are investigating the theory that food can be addictive. Luxuria Hope is one of their test subjects.
When I get upset or nervous, I will go get something to eat. You know, this made me very upset because I find myself eating food and I wasn't hungry.
That's it. Okay, I'm gonna...
Luxuria and the other subjects were starved. When shown their favorite foods, their brain scans showed a release of dopamine, a chemical associated with pleasure.
Dopamine is a very strong system. We're hardwired to go out and seek food, nourishment. And we see these really great foods around, and we go after them because our brain is sort of telling us to. Because there's so much of it available, people are becoming obese.
The scientists discovered Luxuria's brain is less sensitive to dopamine than normal weight people. She has fewer receptor sites, so she needs more food to get the same pleasure. They'd seen a similar pattern with drug addicts.
it's very intriguing because it seems to show a similarity between what's happening in drug addicts' brains with what's happening in obese people's brains. Both of these people, if they're suffering this depletion of dopamine receptors, are trying to stimulate their pleasure circuits in their brain with these artificial means, either by overeating or by taking drugs.
The research suggests why overeating can become addictive.
The act of overeating is decreasing their dopamine receptors, so they're really setting themselves up for this cycle of needing to continue to eat larger amounts of food and to release more dopamine in order to get a pleasure signal.
Luxuria has now had her stomach stapled and lost 7 stone. Going under the knife isn't the only solution. There are other ways than eating to stimulate your dopamine system.
One last little taste of that.
Anything pleasurable will help to stimulate your dopamine system. Anything you find pleasurable, whether it be music or art or going outside, exercise. Exercise, of course, is particularly beneficial if you're trying to lose weight. And the really interesting thing that comes out of our research is that it will increase your dopamine receptor levels. So it will actually counteract this negative effect of overeating by bringing your system back into balance.
Fat gene, addiction, or a combination of both. As scientists make new discoveries, the patients at Brookhaven struggle daily with their compulsion to overeat. Richard Simmons is proof that it can be done. For many, he's become a close friend. Today, he's putting in a personal visit.
Why you got like this?
Eating.
How much have you lost now?
I've lost 330 pounds.
330 pounds. Now that you lost weight, I mean, look at your legs now. What would be the word that you describe yourself as now?
A new life.
A new life.
Younger.
Younger. And yes. Cuter.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah.
There's one person that Richard really wants to see today. He knows his friend and one-time star pupil is in trouble.
Mets won.
Today?
Yeah, 7-1. They whooped your team.
No, they didn't.
Michael has decided to stay at home. Even though he's put on weight, he doesn't want to leave his family to go back to Brookhaven.
Police and Tim's gonna hear me.
When it's time, I will go back. I don't know when that time will happen. But when the time comes, I will go back.
I missed you. What's wrong? How long have I been calling you and talking to you on the phone? How long? How long? 16 years. And you're breaking my heart. Do you want to break my heart?
I want Michael to come back. I think he needs to come back. I think that if Michael doesn't come back, he'll die. And I know he does not want to die. And I know his family does not want him to die. And we don't want him to die.
Patrick Deuel, once the world's heaviest man, is returning to hospital to see how much weight he's lost. This is the first time in 7 years he's been fit enough to make a long trip with his wife, Edie.
I'm sweating like a horse.
I see leaves of green.
Fort Niobrara Wildlife Refuge.
Red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
I'm looking forward to when you can sit up and look out the front window and see what's going on.
Oh, hurry, hurry.
What a porker.
Well, what can I say? How was your trip?
Oh, it was pretty good.
When Patrick left hospital 6 months ago, he was 616 pounds. That's 44 stone. Dr. Harris will be pleased if he's maintained that loss.
Balance.
Yep, go right ahead. Ready?
Okay.
See it?
It's switching between 499.6, 428.
499 for all intents and purposes.
Sounds good to me.
Patrick has lost another 120 pounds, that's 9 stone, in the 6 months he's been at home. Even so, his weight is still dangerously high at 35 stone.
It's excessive in terms of the rest of the world, but remember, Patrick came in dying. His longevity, just before we brought him to the hospital, was measured in terms of days, not in terms of weeks, and now we're going to measure his longevity in terms of years, even if he doesn't drop any more weight.
Since his weight loss, Patrick's life has changed dramatically. Now he can use a bathroom, he can spend the night away from home for the first time since his honeymoon.
Can you hold your feet up that long?
Do I have a choice? I've learned that it's a lot easier to live life and be able to do things when you don't weigh quite so much. I mean, I haven't been this thin for 25 years. They started this thing out by calling me the half-ton man because, I weighed 1,000 pounds. I was looking forward to getting below 500 because that's a quarter ton. So now I'm below that, so I don't have to. They can't measure anything in tons anymore.
He has been so hungry.
Patrick still isn't out of the woods. Stomach reduction operations are usually successful in the short term, but more than half eventually fail. That's because people can't break the habit of overeating.
Oh, we've got chicken here, I think, that I can
put it
in the refrigerator, and then I'll have a snack later when I need one.
More protein.
I was just having my afternoon protein snack.
So you don't seem to have had to change your eating habits too much.
No, not really. I eat pretty much what I want to. I just don't eat as much of it. And I still stay away from the high fat, high sodium things. But pretty much I can eat what I want.
When you stop eating healthy, when you stop moving your body, when you start giving your compliments, give yourself compliments, it's over. You'll go back. People go, well, I'll never gain my weight back. 6 months later, you ain't going to believe what happened, Richard. And it happens. So there is no cure for this. There really isn't.
This is an epidemic now in the United States, but it's rapidly coming in the European Union. As you become Americanized, as we give you our McDonald's and our Arby's and our super size portions, and if you think that the UK is immune, you're going to be sadly mistaken.
Easy. It really does hurt.
Rosalie Bradford is housebound again. An operation to remove excess skin from her legs developed complications, and she can hardly walk. So far, she's defied statistics and is still losing weight.
So
I say we don't buy it no more.
Michael Habranko has still not readmitted himself to Brookhaven.
Seriously.
His struggle with food goes on.
You don't think I'm in physical pain? You don't think I'm scared? Of course I am. I'm human. But if you dwell on it, you know. And you know what? I got up today. And there's so many people I've met in the last 15 years that didn't get up today, that are underground right now. So I'm a pretty lucky guy.